Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss Chief Seattle's speech. Now, this speech was originally orated by Chief Seattle himself on 11th March 1884 in Seattle, and the text is the version 1 which appeared in the Seattle Sunday Star on October 29, 1887. In a column by Dr. Henry A. Smith. Although what he may have said may have been lost in translating and rewriting this speech, but this speech has been widely cited as a powerful bittersweet plea for respect for Native Americans' rights and environmental values. To begin with, let us see a small introduction to Chief Seattle. He was the leader of the Squamish and Duwamish tribe in the Washington Territory in the 19th century. The American city of Seattle is named after him. He is especially known for his speech, or sometimes referred to as a letter, delivered in 1854. This speech was a response to the American government's land treaty to buy the native lands proposed by Isaac Stevens, the then governor of Washington Territory. His speech delineates the Native Americans' reverence for life and respect for human connection with nature. Now let us discuss the various characters that we come across in his speech. To begin with, the first is President Franklin Pierce, the 14th President of the United States, who sent a letter to Chief Seattle communicating the intention to purchase the Northwest Territories. Then we have Governor Isaac Stevens. He was the Commissioner of the Indian Affairs for the Washington Territory. He is also referred to as the White Chief. He met Chief Seattle to discuss the sale or surrender of the land by the Native Americans to the white settlers. George Washington. The natives thought that he was still alive, which is why in the speech he is referred as Great, Good, Big Chief and Good Father. Paleface is referred to the white settlers. Red man is referred to the Native Americans. King George. The Hudson Bay traders called themselves King George's men, so the natives thought that he was the monarch of England, and the white settlers encouraged this deception because if the natives had found out that their monarch was a woman, they would not respect them. Here are some guidelines that I have chalked out, which deduce the important aspects of Chief Seattle's speech. The first one is nature's sympathetic role in the lives of Chief Seattle's tribe. Then the changing times and Seattle's response. Youth's impulsive nature led them into war and destroyed them, their untimely decay of the Native Americans. Everything on earth has life, earth is sacred. The ironic reference to George Washington as good father. The difference between the red man and the white man. The common fate that they share. The red man will perish. The native tribe would agree to sell the land on certain conditions. And the final declaration by Chief Seattle. Now let us discuss the highlights of the speech. Chief Seattle begins his speech by saying that nature has sympathized with his people for many centuries. Today, it is fair, but tomorrow may not be the same, as the great chief in Washington wishes to buy the land. The great chief also sends them word of goodwill and friendship, but he is in little need of their friendship, as his people are strong and powerful as compared to the natives. Chief Seattle says there was a time when his people were large in number, but now they are nothing more than a mournful memory. He will not mourn over their untimely decay. Youth is impulsive, and young men often indulge in revengeful acts, considering them to be gainful. In times of war, they even lose their own lives, but the family that waits for them at home bears the loss. So the natives and the white settlers should never turn hostile to each other. Chief Seattle then refers to George Washington as the good father, who promises the natives that if they do as he desires, he will protect them. Seattle says that the white people's brave men will provide them strength and will protect them from ancient enemies. The natives' god is different to the colonizers' god. The god of the whites protects only the pale-faced children and forsakes the red Indian children. The god of the natives, the Great Spirit, has also forsaken them. If they have a common god, then he is a partial to his European children. There are two distinct races having separate origins and separate destinies. There is a great difference between them. He extols there is a sacredness associated not only with the ashes of their ancestors, but also with this land, which is their resting place. But the whites wander far away from their ancestors' graves. The natives have close association with the dream of their men. The ancestors of the Europeans, that is, after their death, cease to love them. But the Native Americans never forget the world that gave them their being and identity. They keep on loving its valleys, its rivers, its magnificent mountains, and its lakes. Not a single star of hope hovers above the natives' horizons. The winds moan and grim fate follows them. The situation is similar to a wounded doe that is being hunted down. In a few more years, their race will disappear. White settlers too will have their decay, which, though distant, awaits them. However, sharing the common destiny will help both the races. Seattle says that they will accept the governor's proposal for surrendering the lands only on one condition, that they will never be denied the privilege of visiting the tombs of their ancestors. The land is sacred and pure. Every hill, every valley, every plain, and even the rocks, which seem to be lifeless, are holy. Chief Seattle ends his speech by saying that the white man will never be alone. Even when the last native would have perished, these shores will swarm with the invisible dead of his tribe. He requests white men to deal kindly with his people, as the dead are not powerless. Seattle, by the end, states that there is no debt, but only a change of worlds. Now let us discuss the various themes that are derived out from this speech or letter by Chief Seattle. The first is the Red Indians' attachment to the land. Now, one of the most important themes of Chief Seattle's speech is his people's relation with the land. The speech is an emotionally charged response to Governor Stevens' proposal asking the Red Indians to sell the land to the Imperial Masters. But for the Red Indians, the land is not just a piece of earth, but a symbol of their culture and memories. The land, the resting place of their ancestors, is a holy place. Not only the living, but also the dead natives keep loving the land. Seattle makes it clear that the proposal to sell the land will be accepted only on one condition, that they will never be denied the privilege of visiting at any time the tombs of their people, since every part of this soil is sacred for them. Even if they sell it, they won't part from it. The next theme we come across is oppression. The speech delineates the physical and mental oppression meted out to the Native Americans when white settlers came and started colonizing them. The whites unjustly exercising authority over them can be deduced from the speech. The whites are so powerful in terms of the army and navy that the Red Indians need to bow down. Chief Seattle says that the white are willing to allow them enough land to live comfortably, which is symbolic of their master-slave relationship. The next we see is the difference in the tribal belief system and the Western belief system. We will first discuss the tribal belief system. Land is a natural resource. It cannot be possessed by man because all life depends on it. One cannot buy land any more than one can buy sky or air. Every part of the earth, be it a valley, a mountain, a rock, is sacred. We are part of the earth. The earth does not belong to man. Man belongs to the earth. All living and non-living things are our brothers and sisters. We must show the kindness we show to any brother or sister. We must preserve the earth for subsequent generations or coming generations. All things are connected. Man did not weave the web of life. He is merely a strand in it. Do not destroy the forests or pollute the rivers. They are life givers. Now let us see the Western belief system. The universe was made for man. Every square foot of the planet belongs to man. Man was made to rule the world. Man must have mastery over the world and he must conquer the universe. There are no bounds to man's rights to compete with other species. The resources in the world are inexhaustible. We can consume as much as we want. Man was born flawed. Man can get rid of his sins only by strict adherence to institutional Christianity. There is a technological remedy for every problem. Man has the right to unlimited expansion. There is no such thing as global warming, overpopulation, non-renewable resources, or pollution. In Chief Seattle's speech, we also see the clash of two civilizations. Throughout Chief Seattle's speech, the white belief and way of living seems to clash with that of the Native American tribe. Their difference in skin color is emphasized again and again. The difference in their cultural and religious identities is the primary source of conflict between them. To Seattle, whites and the Red Indians are thus like day and night that cannot dwell together. The next theme we see is transcendence. Transcendence means existence beyond the usual limits. The Native Americans would be transported to a reality beyond what is felt by the senses. This land will make them eternal. Their death here would not be death, but on a gateway to the eternal world. The will only change the world and hence will become immortal. Chief Seattle ends his speech with the assertion that the white man and his children would never be alone, as the invisible dead of his tribe or people would be present with them. Then we come across the environmental concerns. Chief Seattle's speech has been described as one of the most beautiful and prophetic statements ever made on the environment. It refers to the Red Indians' respect and love for their land, environment, and nature around them. The speech is the mouthpiece of animistic philosophy, which is the belief system that plants, objects, and natural things such as the weather have a living soul. Seattle in his speech says he cannot comprehend the idea of selling and buying land, as it is a natural resource. It is not a geographical area, but as the ground rich with the blood of his ancestors. Moreover, the world with its valleys, its rivers, its magnificent mountains is alive and precious. These are the resources bestowed to the man, and hence it is important to care for them and thus support sustainable development. It is the duty of man to use the resources, keeping in mind the needs of the future generations. Well, that's all about Chief Seattle's speech, and I hope I have been successful in compiling and simplifying the chapter Chief Seattle's speech for you. Hope you had a fruitful learning experience through this video, and don't forget to like this video and also subscribe to my YouTube channel for more videos. Thank you.